Morning, everybody. Thanks to the Premier too for his stirring words in opening the conference. It's great to see Warren Truss here too. Welcome, Warren, and to other senior ministerial and parliamentary leaders. To Mark Birrell and to Brendan, who do such a terrific job at IPA, and to all of you. As Brendan said, Infrastructure Australia really values its links with IPA and its many members. They help inform the dialogue across the nation about the role that infrastructure plays. And it's also clear to me that it's that cooperative focus, the Business Council of Australia's focus on infrastructure, the Productivity Commission's contribution and leadership in a really important debate are all key parts of this jigsaw. But my message today is clear. That is, without substantial changes, the Australian governments cannot afford the level of infrastructure investment demanded by both the economy and the community. As we've already seen, Victoria and New South Wales have just a few billions in additional investment opportunities left that they can make without constraining their credit ratings. Queensland and South Australia have both been downgraded because the call for public expenditure on recurrent and capital items has outstripped the capacity of those states' budgets. And this story is replicated across Federation. And while the Commonwealth itself retains substantial budget capacity, as we've seen, it would quickly evaporate if the Commonwealth sought to fund the backlog alone, without leveraging investments to drive substantial changes to state finances. The Commonwealth's capacity is real, but it is by no means adequate. The private sector is key. To deliver a sustained increase in the level of infrastructure investment, Australian governments must undertake substantial and wide-reaching reforms to fund infrastructure through increased revenues through targeted taxation, tolling and other user charges, reducing operating expenses to deliver substantial operating surpluses, experimentation and refinement of models to increase private investment, and through the recycling of capital by privatising appropriate existing public assets to fund new infrastructure and to shift the investment burden for existing assets to private owners. The debate about productivity must mature beyond simple restatements of the problem. We must move further towards a genuine process to examine, debate and resolve the reforms needed to bring forward the major transport, utility and social infrastructure projects that will in large part underpin national productivity. In the mid-1980s, Australia's governments faced similar challenges, challenges of inflexibility in the balance sheets and declining productivity. Policymakers responded with a progression of market-based reforms that underpinned our growth through two decades, the floating of the dollar, the deregulation of the financial sector, the lowering of tariff and trade barriers, national competition policies, and related but incomplete deregulation of infrastructure markets, the progressive liberalisation of labour markets, the reform of taxation and prudential regulation, and the development of the Commonwealth Superannuation Guarantee. All represented part of a continuum of reforms that benefited the wider economy and spurred both innovation and investment across the nation, including in infrastructure. The national competition policy in particular seeded bold reforms to create efficient infrastructure markets in areas including freight rail, aviation, telecommunications, and the beginnings of a national electricity market. Taken together, these reforms and others that followed through the 90s facilitated Australia's most sustained period of economic expansion and productivity growth. The liberalisation of the banking sector, for instance, in 1985, was a fundamental step forward and allowed the entry of both foreign capital and global expertise, and saw the development of world-leading innovations, including the public-private partnership model. While the impact of China and Japan and Korea's appetite for our resources must be acknowledged, two decades of uninterrupted economic growth would not have been achieved if it were not for the newfound flexibility of our national economy. But that process of reform has stalled, and growth in our productivity along with it. Australia's ability to compete will be increasingly hampered by inefficient infrastructure unless real solutions are found. And those solutions, I believe, will lie primarily in market-based responses. Markets and infrastructure sectors like energy and communications are reasonably well understood in the community. Prices vary according to demand, and efficient price signals are sent for both consumption and investment. But in other areas like transport, and some cases in some parts of the country, water and social services, both the concept of reform and efficient markets is not well understood, but they are critically important. Markets exist where supply meets demand, where efficient pricing meets the cost of capital in an operation, and where there are sufficient numbers of buyers and sellers to provide for the discovery of end and an efficient price. The challenge to Australia is to begin an honest, rational and evidence-based debate about how market creation can assist to solve the funding challenge, particularly in infrastructure. And I would suggest that the best place to start, if we're going to be serious about productivity, then it should be about completing the national electricity market reforms, the NEM reforms. They have to be our first priority. Completing the NEM requires Queensland, New South Wales and Tasmania to provide their remaining electricity assets to the market so that the NEM can finally operate without distortions and efficiencies across the nation. The inefficient pricing of electricity causes substantial pain to Australian households, and it's eroding the capacity of our businesses to remain competitive. In 1995, the National Competition Policy Agreement saw Australia's NEM states restructure government monopoly electricity businesses to promote efficient markets. And that was well received not only here but globally. It wasn't easy, the reforms were difficult, but they delivered real results. But as I said, more recently, momentum has stalled. Only Victoria and South Australia have achieved competitive, wholly private electricity sectors. In the other states, some or all of its assets are either publicly owned or privately owned, in many cases much of it still government owned. And prices are regulated by governments, and the result is inefficient pricing and distortion. But I would argue that the policymakers in the states where the reform is incomplete should be confident in the outcome of well-executed reform. Since privatising its electricity assets between 1995 and 1997, power prices have been consistently lower here in Victoria than in any other NEM state. In 2011, an Ernst & Young study found the price paid per megawatt hour in Victoria increased by just 7% in real terms from 1996 to 2010. Over the same period, prices in New South Wales and Queensland increased by 45% and 46% respectively. The defence rests its case. But of course, reform is not easy, as the divisive policy debates that have dogged energy reforms in New South Wales demonstrate. But it's important to get the right reforms in place because the consumers benefit. Full electricity reform also represents the best opportunity to break the back of Australia's broader infrastructure funding shortfall. In New South Wales, the sale of network assets would improve the state's bottom line by between $40 and $50 billion. This would represent a generational boost to the state's budget's capacity and equip New South Wales to make transformational investments in new economic and social infrastructure. The same could be said in other parts of the country. No doubt Richard McIndoe's presentation later today will add further depth to this fundamental issue. Turning to transport, because in some ways completing electricity reform is the low-hanging fruit, although it doesn't feel like that. No change, we know, is easy. Transport shortfalls across the freight and passenger networks are imposing substantial productivity constraints on our nation. The Premier has touched on that. By some estimates, congestion on the road network nationally is stripping more than $12 billion from the economy this year alone. And here in Melbourne, road congestion will probably shred something like $4 billion from this state's economy this year. For most road users, access to road network appears free at the point of use because the current opaque charging structure in many cases does not provide motorists with the visibility of the charges they pay. And the current approach does not and cannot adequately reflect the time and location of road use. In the freight sector particularly, the pricing disparities between road and rail have distorted the market. Only 5% of total road costs to freight users stem from road access charging, while for rail freight, track charges account for between 30 and 40% of rail freight costs. The historic demand to mounting, or the historic response to mounting demand has been to add more capacity to the transport network, and this will clearly remain an ongoing requirement. But there are limits to supply-only responses, and Australia's major cities are facing a situation where they can no longer only seek to build their way out of trouble. Policymakers must begin to face up to the challenges and opportunities that are posed by road network congestion, including through the exploration of rational market signals for access to our road networks. Now, I know the political complexity of pricing reforms in the national market are considerable and remain a persuasive force towards retention of the status quo. The reform pathway for achieving change will require a number of steps and the creation of a number of competitive submarkets. And it's likely that large area road pricing for freight vehicles will be the first step. But experience shows that these kinds of reforms require champions, and they're important to the process. And now, with congestion hurting the abilities of businesses and the amenity of household, it's time to begin a mature, dispassionate debate about the options posed by the development of a rational transport market. I do not see this kind of reform as either immediately possible and in some cases immediately acceptable to the motoring public. But we must begin the discussion about the options, the trade-offs and the opportunities to make Australia's freight and passenger transport networks work better. And I look forward to Scott Charlton's contribution on transport markets later this morning and hearing his views about the opportunities that exist to better balance project funding with demand. There are some issues around water as well. They're important. And again, some of the same sorts of signals apply. The creation or completion of markets in electricity, water and transport are important reforms and fundamental to the productivity debate. But solving the infrastructure funding challenge will need to go further and beyond that. Governments cannot expect to be able to fund a larger or even sustain the current levels of capital expenditure without substantial reforms to their own costs. I spoke earlier about the opportunities that exist for asset sales, and they are genuine opportunities to get projects moving in the short term. But the recycling of capital must be accompanied by a complex period of reform to lower the cost of public service delivery. This will be both complex and challenging. Governments must return to a position where they are routinely delivering net surpluses, because only with those surpluses can they fund capital investments. The past decade has seen growth in the operating expenditures by Australia's governments outstrip their revenue growth. Without reform, New South Wales will see social security and welfare costs escalate by 6.6% a year and health by 6.2% a year. But revenue growth is projected to average just 4.9%. Here in Victoria, Michael Vertigan's review of state finances found that Victoria's budget position has declined since the early 2000s. That's been touched on already today, with average annual spending growth outstripping average revenue growth. And Queensland and South Australia's budget challenges are well known. Health costs alone are projected to increase from 15 to 26% of all Commonwealth spending by 2050. And the cost of public health will eclipse the total revenue of most states by the early 2040s. Without reform, governments won't be able to fund all the promises they've made. And we're not the first to have to think about that. In 2011, on public sector reform, the UK's Prime Minister David Cameron said, "I want one of the great achievements of this government to be the complete modernisation of our public services. Like every other Western industrial nation, we won't sustainably live within our means with unreformed public services and out-of-date welfare systems." We know it's difficult. The central goal for government must be the delivery of the best possible services at the best value to taxpayers. And later in the program, three distinguished public sector leaders will discuss these issues. Terry Moran, who, as we know, was the former head of the Victorian and the Commonwealth Public Services. Graham Samuel, formerly chairman of the ACCC, now back in the private sector. And Dr. Kerry Schott, who led the New South Wales Commission of Audit and serves with me on the Infrastructure Australia Council. And I look forward to a lively discussion between them about the options that exist to reform service delivery and fund new infrastructure projects. Ladies and gentlemen, the reforms I've outlined are not all immediately possible, and they will be very difficult, but they are ultimately necessary. In the immediate term, new projects will have to be funded through the sale of existing assets, through public sector borrowing, through tolls, and through the engagement of the private sector. In the medium term, a mixture of new revenue and expense measures will provide a pool of funding to advance well-considered, well-conceived projects. The development of rational markets in transport, utilities, and public services must be a central focus. What Australia is missing in all of this is a uniting national context with which to undertake reforms. The experience of the NCP shows that a burning platform is required to drive consensus about reform. I would argue that burning platform exists because governments, business and the community are in furious agreement about the need for better infrastructure outcomes. The role of formal institutions like Infrastructure Australia, like the Productivity Commission, the National Water Commission, and the important contribution of bodies like Infrastructure Partnerships and the various state-based bodies, they all have a substantial role to play in doing the heavy lifting to articulate the case for change. But formal institutions can only inform the public debate. Only Australia's governments can drive and lead these kinds of changes. What is needed is a formal process to examine the rationale and requirement for change, and to provide a uniting national process to identify, assess, experiment and implement the transformational changes that will allow Australia to better its contemporary challenges. I'm sure that today's conference will help deliver some of the key, clear recommendations about the sorts of changes we need, and that today's proceeding will help to ignite the reform debate. Thank you.